thrilled to have you here in the Global Power Platform Bootcamp. And I am Sanjiv Venkatram from Singapore, and we have a full quorum online. And then we are extremely thankful to Microsoft and Kingsway Soft for actually sponsoring this global event. And to all our community leads, both here and in Malaysia, for making this happen. And a huge thanks to Ange Cerbolles for getting us Microsoft Teams to be able to host this event. And it also happens to be our first webinar here in either Singapore or Malaysia. So we're extremely thrilled to be able to have this online. And then going forward, our goal actually is to have this webinar across ASEAN, actually including our friends in Thailand, Indonesia, and Philippines. I think we are up on time. And with a bit of an introduction and a huge thanks to the community and Microsoft for making this happen, let's actually get started. We have a full agenda today, going all the way until 5:30. So I'll with this and with many thanks to the MVPs, Jeevarajan Kumar here in Singapore and potential MVP Dharani in Malaysia, we hand it to Akhil Dubey to kick off the first session. Akhil, you're there?
Yep. Yes, Sanjiv.
Wonderful, you know. And one last thing, folk, we're actually going to be recording these sessions. So just for awareness, you know. And should you have any questions, it would be very kind if you could text your question in the chat window. Okay. Thank you very much. Akhil, off to you, you know.
Thanks, Sanjiv. Hello, everyone. So we would be starting our first session on the Technology Dynamics 365 for Marketing. And the goal is to understand how to find the right prospects and build long-lasting relationships using Dynamics Marketing. So together with me, this session will be driven by Sanjiv, and we will give a brief introduction about both of us. Sanjiv has just briefly spoken about himself. Just to go further, he is our Dynamics 365 Business Applications and Power Platform Community Leader here in Singapore and has been leading from the front for last, I'm the part for last 1 year, and I'm seeing it's all tremendous that's going on here. He's also heading the business at Prudentia Consulting Singapore. And I am Akhil, Akhilesh Dubey. I am also part of the Dynamics 365 Business Applications and Power Platform community here in Singapore. And on the work front, I am a pre-sales solutions specialist in KPMG Asia Pacific. Just to touch base on the objectives that we are looking to have in this session is explore and do a deep dive on Dynamics 365 marketing capabilities around attracting the right prospects, leads, opportunities, personalizing the customer journeys, doing the automation of the campaigns, running business unit level marketing for the large enterprise, which are having multiple businesses scattered across the different verticals and horizontal. We will also delve a little into event management capabilities of the application and the platform. And the real focus is basically to establish the point that Dynamics is basically a uniform or a connected platform which connects your sales and the marketing departments for an enterprise. And which is basically a very, very important thing, because marketing and sales teams very frequently they are so at loggerheads and working in silos, blaming each other for the mayhem, that there should be a strong platform where they can converge their data points and information. We will also touch base upon simplifying collaboration across the different productivity tools, office tools, and social media collaboration as well. And all that is going to help us make informed decisions in our marketing and sales business process and help us grow with an adaptable platform. In terms of agenda, we will be quickly looking into the business challenges that the sales and marketing teams generally come across. And we'll have an overview of Dynamics 365 marketing and how does it help us solve those business challenges. We'll do a brief application demo to give a heads up on what all is possible from the application platform. And then we'll be open to take some questions and share thoughts with everyone here in the forum. So in terms of business challenges, I would ask Sanjiv to probably shed more light on what are the typical business challenges the marketing and sales teams generally come across.
Sure thing, Akhil. And, you know, the conversation here is actually, let's tag team because you have a wealth of experience as well, is if we kind of sort of net it out into four, basically leads are the first point into actually converting anything into a sale. So there's a lack of, let us say, lead generation from a marketing standpoint for salespeople to actually act on. The leads actually turn into opportunities that salespeople actually follow up on and close. So if you don't have insufficient leads, clearly you don't have enough opportunities to work on. The other thing is, as Akhil was pointing out, sales and marketing in many companies are two distinct functions. And given that one is actually tied closer, if you will, to engineering and product, and one's actually right in front of the customer day in, day out, there can be tensions and you know, they don't exactly work together seamlessly. So that's another one. The other issue, and this is a perennial issue basically, is not enough information or data to actually make smart decisions. And finally, you know, systems come in the way of being obstacles to being efficient across the sales and marketing funnel. And Akhil, it would be great if you could provide a couple examples as well as to what you've seen as to what these challenges manifest themselves as, you know.
Yes, Sanjiv. Yes. So when it comes to actually getting your leads, there are multiple ways that organization adopt. And it was pretty simple, probably a decade back, where you could have generated your leads from all the organic or inorganic ways, or third party lists coming from third party sources, meeting people somewhere over an event, probably in a party, and then exchange business cards. And then look into seeing whether they can be a prospect to you. But in last almost a decade or so, things have become pretty complex because people are now more sensible around sharing their personal data and information. And then there are typically very strong laws across the globe, may it be the GDPR, which is applicable globally, or it may be the local PDPA Act, which is prevalent in Singapore. You are just not allowed to make use of anyone's mobile number or probably reach out to them over email with anything that you are trying to offer. There has to be a very systematic approach and a willingness from your prospects or the people you come across, organizations you come across, who say that, yes, I am interested in your offerings, in your products and services, and I encourage you to reach out to me and share your details.
Perfect, you know. Yep, let's keep going.
Okay, so I have some of the data or the metrics to understand why do we need to have better tools to align sales and marketing, and why is it very essential and critical as well. So, as per some of the studies, it says that only 57% of business-to-business purchasing decisions are made before ever speaking to a salesperson, which means that the mind-making or probably the willingness to actually buy a product or service happens much before the very first touch point from your organization. So that means people would have already researched what they want to buy, what they want to subscribe, what they want to opt to. And that is where it becomes challenging and very competitive for the marketing marketers and the salespersons to actually get a share of the pie. And then close to 49% of the sales representatives ignore more than half of the marketing lead, which means that this clearly establishes that there is a disconnect, wherein marketing folks would work in a certain way and they would see some of the prospects as valuable. But because of lack of communication or probably passing across the right information or sharing it in a more sensible way, there is a disconnect and the sales reps won't take it seriously. And that's where they lose the business. So having a connected platform helps there. And then 8% of responders said it was difficult to align sales and marketing data, companies and contacts, because they were on different platforms. So that is where then products like Dynamics Marketing take an edge over their peers like, I don't want to name them, but yes, that's where we take the lead. And then, so looking at all these scenarios, how does Dynamics 365 Marketing helps, and how does it help the people who have subscribed to it or bought it to fare ahead? So I will ask Sanjiv to basically go into the elements of the marketing process and help us understand further.
Thank you very much, Akhil. And really quickly, I think, you know, one of the most important things as I see it is to actually understand the business from the business, get down to the business processes, and from there actually adopt a bunch of technologies that actually help, you know, make your business processes efficient and solve, you know, problems in the market. When you break down what is what marketing is and how key it is in any company, there are two basic elements to it. There is strategic marketing, and then, like, you know, the follow-ups on the tactical side. From a strategic perspective, you've got segmentation, targeting, and positioning, STP to be short. And this is extremely important. To give you an example, if you're in the US, and if you're General Motors, and if you're actually manufacturing Hummers, and if you're actually thinking of coming to Japan or to India as a market, a Hummer may not even fit in the street, you know. So when you look at how do you want to have your, like, you know, product and position it in the market, it's very important, very strategic to think about alignment of what you're actually trying to, you know, produce and sell to what actually the market needs are. From a segment standpoint, what that means is you got to look at your geography, your areas, regions, cities, etc. You got to look at, like, you know, the demographics. Which industry are you in strong in? Are you in education? Are you in manufacturing? Are you in financial services? The size of the company. Does a company have over 1,000 people, or is it a small and medium company? All these things actually go into forming segmentation. And things around the nature of purchasing, et cetera. Do you have existing relationships, or, you know, purchasing functions are grouped? Is it centralized, decentralized? All these go into forming what are called as customer segments. Then you get into things around tactically. We are not getting into each one, but really quickly, from a technical standpoint, you get into pricing. Hey, are you actually going to do a cost plus kind of pricing? Or are you going to look at perceived value of your product in the market? As an example, a Ferrari or a Maserati is actually thought of as very high end. You know, there could be perceived value. Then you have the examples on distribution channels, direct sales, telemarketing, retail, etc. And we get down to things like advertising. We have industry events, social media, to whatever Akhil talked about. Hopefully this gives you an idea of all the touch points within the marketing lifecycle that we have to manifest in the tool or in Dynamics 365. So we'll actually, like, you know, unpeel that, touch upon a few things with demos, and I'll hand it back to Akhil.
Yeah, so in terms of having the customer engagement, it's not something that particularly for business to business scenario or for the products which where the life cycle is really big, where you have the demand generation, wherein you are generating awareness with the strategic campaigns, you are doing the search engine optimization, you are doing you are tapping the footprint of anonymous visitors on your website, or probably reaching out to them to basically help them subscribe to your newsletters, or probably come to your website, move around, see your product offerings and everything. this is where you basically tap the interest of the people, and that then manifests whether they have enough awareness and they are in a good position to take informed decision about the product or service they are going to consume. It can be a mobile phone. It can be professional services, which may cost like multi-million dollars. So anything of that sort needs some kind of demand generation and some touch points for your prospects to basically take informed decisions buying your services. And this is not just single channel from where you can reach out to them and they would be researching on the websites. They would be looking into the social channels to see what people are speaking about their experiences around your products and services. They will be seeing how people are tweeting about you. They will see the product reviews on the different third-party websites. And you have to very cautiously plan all your moves so that wherever they go, wherever they want to understand about your product and service, they kind of feel a very consistent experience and consistent brand value. And then once they have made the decision, they have purchased your products or services, that's where the operations part kicks in as to how are you orchestrating the services flow or probably the working of your product. And then comes the service part of it. So once they have started using your product or they have engaged you for rendering services to them, there would be service scenarios. They will have requests, they will have queries, they will have complaints. They will have ways to move around. They will like to understand how to find their way into your product or service. So all that basically is the part of the customer service department, and that's where they engage through multiple channels. Like they will be reaching out to you over web chat. They will be calling you up on phone. They will be dropping emails, raising tickets on your ticket portal. So and then you have to give them a consistent experience all across. And depending upon how it went with them while consuming your first product or service, they will take the decision whether they are going to commit their loyalty to your offerings. And you have a chance to upsell and cross-sell your offerings and then maintain the brand loyalty. So to basically facilitate all this process, all the way from demand generation to consuming of the service, to all the way to upsell, cross-sell, Dynamics Marketing is a tool which basically helps you, first of all, find who are your right prospects and not just go around seeing every single person who is coming across and showing interest. Some of them may be researching, some of them may be doing it for study purpose, they may not be really interested in buying your services. So you have to be very specific to understand who are the ones who are really interested. What are the demographics of the people? Where they are located? Which part of the world? What are their age group? What is the gender of the people? You have to understand all those things. And that is what is called as a smart prospecting. And then once you have zeroed upon your target segment, then you have to start targeting them and start positioning. So put together in marketing world, this entire strategy is called as STP, which is segmentation, targeting, and positioning. So segmentation is like putting them into the right buckets as to who you may be having a variety of services and products that you are selling. Which is the right product and service for which particular segment of customer? That is what you need to decide very smartly and perfectly.
Exactly, Akhil, and sorry to interject over here. And that is a very, very important consideration, you know, in the sense that if you're actually talking to public sector customers, especially defense customers, and if you're barking up a tree saying cloud, they might not be amenable to letting their data go into the cloud. So these are practical examples of how segmentation actually works and as to how marketing thinks about, let us say, the market in order to position the right product in the right market and talk to engineering to bake in some of the needs of, let us say, the defense industry in their clouds. Sorry, back to you, Akhil, just to kind of give you a customer perspective, you know.
Right. Yes, Sanjiv. Exactly. That's what it is. So organizations like Microsoft and all, they have to be very cautious when their offering is scattered all the way from public commercial cloud to government public cloud and then government private cloud and a lot of different offerings. And then it's really important because there are organizations of different nature who just cannot let their data go off and be launched on the cloud. So that is where Dynamics Marketing helps you adopt a very sensible approach in making smart decisions. And then scalability also comes into picture, where you have to be adaptable. There are a lot of different ways. So marketing and sales is not the same which it used to be in 50s or 60s, where you have very personal connect with the customer. You know their likings, dislikings, and you can connect with them, talk to them in person. Here we are talking about customers who are in millions, or prospects who are in millions scattered across the globe. You cannot simply think of reaching out to them in person. So you need to have a tool that can segregate smartly and then help you reach out to them very effectively.
Excellent, Akhil. Actually, you know, in the interest of time, perhaps we could, you know, obviously here is a slide that talks about uniqueness of value and, you know, living together on Dynamics 365 on the same platform across sales, marketing, customer service, et cetera, and everything being secure and trusted. Let us move into maybe the, how do you say, the net out slide and into the demos, you know, if you don't mind.
Yeah. So this slide particularly talks about all the exhaustive features that are available in the platform, starting from multi-channel campaigns all the way to marketing automation and reaching out to the customers via email marketing, having landing pages where people are coming, they are keying in some of their data, showing interest, or probably downloading one of your newsletters, subscribing to your webinars or newsletters and things like these. UI or probably the touch points really need to be very fascinating compared to what they used to be. So a simply written wordy email may not appeal when there are everyone in the market who are rubbing shoulders with you and showing fascinated offerings. So, and then obviously, as I said, the decision to buy a product is not taken in malls and shops these days. People are sitting at the comfort of their homes, logging onto their laptops, and then moving around into different social channels, into different websites and portals to understand what are your offerings and what are your competitors and what is their needs, what exactly fits to them, and then taking the decision. And then once the demand has been generated, you as a marketer or the marketing or sales team, you need to understand how to nurture these leads, which are the ones who can become hot or warm for you. So when I say warm or hot, basically this is how the lead or prospecting cycle happens. First of all, everyone is cold for you because you don't know whether they have any interest in your product or offerings. Then basically you see their behavioral approach, whether they are engaging you with your websites, they are surfing through your web pages, going into certain particular pages which showcases your product specification. And that's where all these behavioral touch points, like clicking a link on the email or probably going to the landing page, spending some time on your website, everything can build up towards the score and which can take your lead from cold to warm and eventually from warm to hot, where the marketers are good to take the decision to hand it over to the sales team.
And that's an important point, guys, and not just from, how do you say, I mean, it's live, it's real action. For those of whom you're actually like, you know, techno-functional consultants, these are things that actually appear on your MB200 exam as an example. So just to kind of give you a different perspective. Back to you, Akhil.
Yeah, and as part of your marketing and sales endeavor, there is one thing that is very important, that is the events. So events are similarly, just like we are on an event now, which is a webinar for our technology interest. Similarly, the companies or organizations, they run workshops, they conduct the global sales meetup, distributors workshop. So sometimes where it is like B2B2C scenario, where businesses are selling to another businesses and eventually going to customers, you have a chain of your subsidiaries or your sales facilitators, like your distributors, your dealers, your sub dealers, and then you have to often engage them to basically tutor them how to effectively market or sell your product. So all those basically are events, and then people who are coming to those events, whether they are actual customers or prospects or your partners, you need to understand the interest that they have shown. You need to plan, execute, and do the post-event activities very carefully then only you are trying to understand what is the return on investment you are getting. The events are really costly. If you are trying to get an event, a business event done in Singapore, you will end up doing it at one of the expo halls or probably in one of the conference ballrooms in Marina Bay Sands, which like costs tens of thousands of dollars. After investing all that, paying stipends to speakers, arranging food and frolic for them, what are you going to get in the return? So you have to gauge that return on investment. So all that is part of the event management cycle. And then obviously you have to go to smart reporting, slicing and dicing your data, having a 360 degree view of your leads and prospects, and see all your interactions and insights. So all that is basically the features in marketing.
Akhil, actually one quick point, and let's actually get into the demos. The real issue actually often comes in where there is a lack of integration between, you know, sales and marketing, and that usually points to lack of having a unified platform between sales and marketing. So that one line item that you call sales integration as an example is absolutely incredible to see where you bring the two together, right? Where you have sales and marketing together and the visibility is end to end. With that, when we actually get into, like, you know, the demos.
Perfect.
Yep.
Okay, so just let me know if everyone is able to see the Dynamics marketing interface.
Loading up, okay.
Yep. Okay, so what you see on your screen is basically the interface for Dynamics for Marketing. And basically, this is the out-of-the-box landing page, which, because this is a new offering, it tells you a lot of tutorials like how to design your emails, how to basically find and construct your segments, marketing lists, subscription lists, and so on. And then basically doing the campaign automation or basically orchestrating your customer journeys. To your left-hand side, you see a lot of different functions around your day-to-day work, your dashboards, where you see all the analytics around your marketing and sales. And this is pretty much seamlessly integrated with Power BI. So all your Power BI dashboards and everything would be available along with your activity listing, like your tasks, appointments, phone calls, emails, and everything. So apart from that, depending upon whether you are a B2B or B2C business, you have all your accounts who are your B2B customers and your contacts who are your B2C customers, your partners, individuals that you deal with, people that you come across, exchange cards, everyone is segregated here. Segments are basically, as I had said, these are the different buckets where you segregate your customers, and it is part of your STP strategy, segmentation, targeting, and position. So segments are where you actually slice and dice people or organizations. So these segments are basically formed of two kind of buckets. One is your static marketing lists and dynamic marketing lists. So static marketing list is just pick and choose random people based on your intelligence. And dynamic are the ones where basically you give a criteria that I want a person from this geography in an age group between 20 to 30 years who has shown interest or clicked one of my emails and things like these.
And a quick point on segments over there, because that is so critical, is that usually segmentation data comes in from sources like, let us say, Dun & Bradstreet, who actually have a list of all customers, let us say, within Singapore. And they have some information, industry information, as to which industry the customer is actually from, what is the annual revenue of these, how many employees do they actually have, and any kind of contacts. And then you augment that with some information that's available internally as well as from social media, and you get your segment. You know, as an example, KPMG is a global client. I mean, it's, you know, you've got KPMG in the US, UK, everywhere else. So it's a global client. KPMG is also here in Singapore. So that's like a child ID, if you will, of the global parent. Back to you, Akhil.
Right. And once you have done the segmentation of your prospects, that is where you basically plan your move ahead as to how do you want to engage with them. From the point where you make your first move, in the sense that you launch yourself in form of different tweets or posts into the social media to engage people who you don't know about. So you are basically generating the interest in the market, and depending upon who has showed the very first response, like clicked your email, went into your web page, or probably went into social media, tweeted back about your offering, that is where you basically get into saying that, okay, I want to segment them into a particular bucket, and then I want to get into reaching out to them. So that is where you do the segmentation. And with segmentation, you basically do the next move as to whether you will be sending another email to engage them with details of your offerings. Now, Sanjiv, you would like to add something to this?
Sure. A couple of points here. These also actually get into, let us say, you know, you have segmented a whole bunch of customers as, let us say, belonging to manufacturing, you know. You could take those set of customers and actually invite them to an industry event that, like, you know, the one that happened recently in Singapore at the expo, where there were a whole bunch of manufacturing clients across actually ASEAN who came into Singapore to be at this event. So that's yet another example of actually reaching out to customers post segmenting. Back to you, Akhil.
Right. And then these journeys are typically the automated way, because as I had said in the beginning, that if you are a big business, you cannot just randomly plan your moves. You have to have a strategy in place that how are you going to engage based on a certain behavioral response from the customer. Like if they have clicked your email, whether you want to convert them into a lead. So as you see here, this particular customer journey branches out very beautifully and says that if a person has really clicked your email, create a lead and then pass it forward based on the nurturing or lead scoring. And if they have not clicked for a week or so, probably then reach out to them in a follow-up call. So this customer journey or orchestration can be made pretty complex depending upon complexity of a business.
Sorry to interject over there. Guys, we're actually hearing some background noise. If you could kindly mute so that there is no disturbance of the call, would be very kind, you know. Back to you, Akhil.
And then the emails can be really fascinating based on very smart templates, having a lot of graphics, your product pictures and everything. And platform really provides all that for you in terms of email templates, which you can link with your campaign emails. Another very interesting part is basically the event management. So generally, when you basically get into running an event like the one we are running now, there is a lot of planning that goes behind it. There is a lot of collaboration that goes behind it. There is a lot of back office processing that needs. You have to have a portal in place. It's not the era where people just come to your registration counter or concierge randomly and start registering yourself. And then an event like the one we are running today or any other global event cannot be successful in the scale and the beauty that they are run. So if you have a very strong engine in place, which can quickly churn out a portal the moment you have planned and keyed in your events, that's really beautiful. So I will just quickly delve into one of these events. So for example, here you see there are a lot of events that I see here. Like there is a workshop, 1, 2, 3, 4. So these can be anything like distributor meet, a dealer's training, or probably a open house or expo or something. And once you have got into this planning mode as to what are the dates, when do you want to run, what is the time zone where you are going to run, what is the venue, what is the registration count that you are looking at based on the venue capacity, whether you are allowing a wait list or not, who are the speakers, who are the sponsors. Once you have keyed in everything and you have decided, that's where you go live and it beautifully churns out a portal. I mean, as beautiful as this. This is the most simplistic one, but this is itself is very beautiful for someone like me who is not an HTML developer. So the moment you launch the event there, it's up and running as a live website, which can be flashed on your email and marketing materials for people to come register themselves and then basically choose the different sessions. I'm sure you must have done a similar thing for Microsoft Ignite, which was built on a similar dynamics instance. So you can track all your registrations, which all sessions people have opted for, what are their food preferences, are there any special needs around picking them from airport, if it is basically an event where people are flying around from different parts and you have to do hotel bookings, room bookings, everything, you can track over here. You can also associate what are the costs involved in basically arranging these venues, speaker fees, logistics, catering, and everything. And then all that basically comes into your P&L in your accounting as to what is it that you invested in running these events and what is the ROI that you got out of it. So when I say ROI, how does it come out as? People who would have attended these sessions would turn out to be your leads who will then graduate into opportunities, eventually buying your services and providing you revenues. So you can link it back to campaigns.
Yes, and that's a very important point for marketers especially because they're constantly under the gun for providing ROI. And since they actually are not direct salespeople who are talking to customer and closing deals, there is a notion that, hey, look, you know, we are doing all these events. What does it actually mean in terms of closing something at the end? So it is a very hard conversations that marketers actually face in terms of like, you know, what is the ROI? In fact, back in November, one of the gentlemen who came in from Microsoft to an event talked exactly about that. And something like this helps you associate a number and then say, this is how effective our event was actually, you know, delivered. And here are the actual warm leads that we've been able to generate for sales to follow up upon. Back to you, Akhil.
Right. So with that, I would go to another interesting area which dynamics marketing carries, that is the lead scoring models. Now, lead scoring models are basically an intelligent way of understanding how your leads are getting nurtured and moving towards the bottom of the funnel. Because earlier, the marketing and sales used to be gut feeling of very experienced people. And it used to be like a family business wherein your boss who had spent 25 years of time would pass on his skills on to you. But now it is no more the same thing. Everything is scientifically driven as to how people are interacting with your services. What are their behaviors around your website? How they have engaged with your emails? How many times they have clicked it? How much time they have spent on your website? Everything gets captured in the behavioral score. And this behavioral score, when it builds to a certain level, it basically graduates your lead from cold to warm or warm to hot. And then there can be other scores like demographic scores. Now, this is where we need to understand the demographics of the people. What are their genders? What are their age groups? If we are actually selling honeymoon packages, have the people who click the link are actually 50 over? And then obviously, I mean there can be people, but those may not be your diamond mines. There will be people from a different age group who would be the best prospect for that kind of offering.
And the brilliant point about this is that it links back to your STP, you know, the segmentation that you were actually like, you know, talking about earlier, Akhil. Here, it actually is a direct link to that to kind of say, what did you plan? What did you achieve?
Right. And for your B2B businesses, just like demographics for your individuals, you can build firmographic score. As Sanjiv was telling that your prospect come from which industry segment, whether they are retailers, whether they are manufacturers, whether they are finance companies, or what are their number of employees, annual revenues, and things like this. So those all help you build the firmographic score around your B2B prospects. Just in the interest of time, I'll quickly go into the social media part of it because that kind of generates a lot of interest. You need to reach out to your prospects from various different social media channels where people are spending most of their time online. So if I just quickly go into the advanced settings of marketing, you will see that there is something called as the social configuration. So now this particular tool can be a container for all your social media activities that you want to plan as the marketer or seller for as an individual or an organization. So you must be, as an organization, you may be having a Facebook page, a LinkedIn company page, or probably a Twitter account where you want to flash very important updates, events, happenings, offerings, everything. So you can configure all your Facebook pages, LinkedIn pages, Twitter pages, and this platform really talks to these social media channels seamlessly. It authenticates based on the credentials that you have provided. I'll just quickly go into one of these to show you how they look like. So you will say, okay, what is the social channel? What is it? Facebook? And then basically you go to authorize, because you need to provide your credentials, because they are different platforms, very securely driven. And once you authorize yourself, everything that you launch as a social post in your customer journey start appearing as a Facebook post based on your strategy. Similar thing goes with Twitter posts and the LinkedIn posts. Just in the interest of security and so that they do not become very outdated, you may need to reauthorize yourself after 60 days or 90 days with these platforms, depending upon the policy that they have set for themselves. So these are few of the things. And then obviously from marketing, because everything is built on common data service, all your account and contact pretty much go and sit in the same database that your sales team may be accessing. And anything that basically graduates in your sales marketing journey can be seamlessly passed over after a certain score has been built to your sales team to deal with.
And it can be a constant feedback cycle between sales and marketing, in that they actually, the sales guys actually see the same data as to what the marketing guys are actually seeing, so that you don't have that kind of a friction anymore where, you know, people are saying, hey, I don't even know this account from a sales standpoint. And those sort of scenarios don't come about. Okay. Akhil, I think we've got about a couple more minutes. Let us quickly net the demos out and go back to the business challenge slide. So we can, like, you know, call out aspects that we walked through in the demo.
So we saw that the businesses face challenges like insufficient lead generation because they are not reaching out to the right prospects through right channels. And with dynamics marketing, as we saw that, it's pretty systematic to basically segregate them into the right segments and then reach out to them via the multi-channel through emails, SMSs, tweets, posts, LinkedIn posts, and so on. And then we saw the seamless data that is present between the sales and marketing team and a very elegant and a very
elegant interface. Yeah.
And then we have a lot of plethora of information coming from different sources that help us make smart decisions and take away the obstacles working with other systems.
And essentially, since everything is actually, like, you know, sitting on common data service, it actually comes together in one place, as opposed to being in multiple places and not informing synergies.
Right.
Yeah. And then, you know, Akhil, one last thing that we talked about is, because of the infusion of AI now right into the apps, you can actually, like, you know, query how your product is actually placed within the market. I mean, you go into, you know, AI for marketing and actually, like, plug in Dynamics 365, and it'll actually, like, bring out a whole bunch of, like, you know, buzzwords, if you will, around that, which can kind of sort of inform you as to where your product's actually going, what is the sentiment in the market, etc. Right. So to that business challenge, which is fantastic, like, you know, 4 points, Dynamics 365 is able to address a large chunk of what is coming out as, what has come out as, marketing challenges.
Right.
So folks, you know, I hope you get an idea of, like, you know, A, what are the business challenges in marketing? B, what does the marketing process flow actually look like? C, what are the individual elements of Dynamics 365 that actually address these challenges? And then it hopefully gives you an idea as to how to engage your business at your firms, or if you're techno-functional consultant, as to what are the things that the business side is actually, the marketing side is actually looking at as you engage with them in conversations, and then make things better on both sides, the techno-functional side as well as on the business side. With this, we thank you very much for the opportunity. And then we'll call upon Geetha Chockalingam to come in and inform us about CDM, et cetera. Okay, Geetha, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Sanjiv. Hey, before we move on with my session, if anyone has any questions, feel free to ask so. I'll just give a couple of minutes.